Welcome, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. This is obviously an extremely hot topic, and I'm really excited to have a couple of panelists here with us this morning, Sanjeev and Derek. Sanjeev, if we can go to the next slide here, is the physiotherapist and currently the chief revenue officer at Clinic Accelerator. Just an incredible wealth of knowledge. And Derek Purvis, really excited to have join us today. Physiotherapist, clinic owner here in Winnipeg. I have to say, Derek, I think local is one of our oldest clients at the moment. And Derek's been doing a fantastic job and growing over the last couple of years as well. So I'm going to have less involvement in this discussion. These two gentlemen have far more experience in retaining staff in your clinics. And in our discussions over the last week or two have shown that they have just a wealth of knowledge. So on this next slide, you'll see that obviously this is an extremely hot topic, very top of mind for clinic owners right now. And there does seem to be, just in the discussions that I've heard from other clinic owners, a real competitive landscape for trying to recruit and retain quality staff. You know, from a personal perspective in our business, in the software business, I've personally found that culture for me has been one of the biggest benefits to retaining staff. And I've been really lucky in that, you know, my first employee is still an employee at Jovano after 20 years. So, but when it comes to the clinic sense and environment, obviously culture's huge, but we're going to get into some more details into the compensation plans and how your teams work together and people are paid and the structure of their payments and things like that too. Ensure that they stay engaged with your clinics. So on the next slide, during our conversations, Derek had brought up quite a few wins and losses. And so I wanted to actually bring that into this discussion. So I'm gonna, Derek, maybe if you wouldn't mind elaborating a little bit on what's made you so successful in some of the learning experiences you've had along the way, so that maybe you can explain a couple of the pitfalls that the other clinic owners on this call might be able to avoid.
Yeah, sounds good. Thanks for having me, first of all. A short bit about myself. I bought my first clinic in 2019 and have grown and have three physical ones and a mobile one now, and between 50 and 55 staff. And keeping staff motivated, not so much motivated, but even recruiting people and retaining them has been one of my biggest focuses since starting. I think from the beginning, we recognized that the classic pay model of purely a fee split for clinicians was good in the past, and newer clinicians weren't as interested in that, or some weren't anyways. So right from the start, we tried to find a pay model that was more attractive to newer clinicians, and then also eliminate burnout, which was really evident for myself and for my partner, Joe, at my first clinic. Something we experienced and wanted to identify what caused it and find ways to improve that within our clinic and within our pay models. So what we've settled on is, I guess the first part is understanding what your staff are looking for. What do your people want? What motivates them? And that could be different in different places, different for different roles. And we've found that a hybrid pay model for our clinicians has been successful for our newer grads. We found some of them were getting more attracted towards the public sector, where they've got more security, more stability, benefits, all that kind of stuff. So we wanted to find a way to do that. And then losses, there's certainly been quite a few losses. Anytime you start changing pay models and you're not an actuary, you take on a lot of risk. And we've certainly lost a lot of money over the years trying to work out how to do it. So we originally started with this hybrid pay model, part salary, part commission, and tried it out on myself and my business partner, Joe. And it worked really well for us. We found that we could offer holiday time, sick time. We had some security. We also had motivation for seeing patients, and it worked really well. And we found we brought some new clinicians on, put them on this pay model, and found out. Turns out, if you're not a clinic owner, seeing 20 patients a day maybe isn't ideal, and so we really had to recognize that the numbers don't always add up, and you have to. So we had to tweak them a few times. But if you get caught in a contract, it can be impossible to get out of it unless you've built ways into that. So we've had some misses along the way, and really paid quite a bit to make up for that. But we've tweaked it, and now I think we've worked in ways to review the contract every few months and make sure it's working for everybody. So, one other more specific loss, we did try a pure hourly model, and we've used that for newer clinicians coming out of school because it gives some security to them. But we found that has a pretty short runway, where a couple of months later, all of a sudden, their billings, they look at those and they look at what they're getting for hourly, and even though we're matching rates that they would get at the hospital, it really starts to make more sense for them to switch to a fee split. But they may not know that I'm open to that, even though we've said, let's discuss it. And so found that some people will, we've had people jump ship and go to another clinic because they look at the fee split. And so those are a couple losses, but I think the biggest win is that we have found a way to create a better culture, support our clinicians, support our staff, invest in people, grow them, and still keep the clinic going along the way.
Excellent.
Yeah, I like what you said, like both Terry, you from like the culture point of view, and then Derek, like sharing your losses and then what you had to change. So, and thanks again, Terry, for having me on. I have known Derek for a long time, so this is definitely like a topic we've discussed like multiple times. So just in terms of like retaining your staff, I think you touched on a lot of these, Derek, is like competition. So what I see out there is very traditionally like there's less than 1% unemployment for clinicians. So it's difficult finding people, but then also difficult retaining them because when you have such low unemployment, you have a lot of competition, poaching, people making offers. So, and even now more so, what's most recent, you have like chiropractic owners who hire physios, right? And they give them higher splits, or physio owners that hire chiros and give them a different split. Where back in the day, I think it was more physio-based clinics and chiro-based clinics. Now they're mixed, so the splits are changing quite a bit. Okay. Also, personal factors in retaining your staff, like someone that you hired as a new grad, sure, it was easier to retain them, but then as they maybe want to pay down their debt or they're having a baby, they have personal factors where they want to make more. And if you're not in tune with that, you could lose them. Okay. Certainly macroeconomic factors like inflation, I don't know if it needs that much explanation. What happens when inflation goes up? They come to where they work and say, hey, am I going to be able to make more here or should I start looking elsewhere? Okay. I talked to a lot of people who are intrinsically motivated. So this kind of goes with the 7-year itch. Like they always knew they wanted to have their own business or do something more, or I don't know, we call it kind of like 5-year itch or 3-year itch now. We're like, oh, I'm a clinician. Is this all I'm going to be doing? And they start looking for other pathways to diversify their work or make more money. Derek, is there something missing? Or have I hit the major like tones?
I think you hit the major parts there, and especially that last one of giving career progression is really important.
Yeah. So in this talk, like, how are we going to respond to these things? Okay, how are you going to respond to the to these factors? And we're going to provide like a path on what's really worked for me over the last 20 years is, and again, I'm kind of like Derek, like this didn't come from me winning, it came from me losing, learning the hard way, like a lot of losses, setting expectations early on. Okay, and we're going to look at some tools. How do you set expectations on people's pay? Like Terry, you said the culture, what the culture's like. Okay. I found the like if you don't set expectations, what do people do? They go to like the lowest common denominator. They think something malicious is happening, or something behind their back. So you got to set expectation when it comes to their pay or the culture or how they can progress. So we're going to look at a tool that you can do that. Set a clear path for them. Okay. Not only set expectations, but hey, where can you go in the company? So I don't know, Derek, how do you kind of tell people like, where can you go in the company? How do you explain that to them or message that to them?
We have a career path laid out, and we have a presentation that shows where they can go if they're interested in being a clinician. We're willing to fully fund them going through their FCAMP program. We have continuing education to help support them, internal education programs. And then if their interest is in management, we have positions to move into lead clinician, clinic director, equity partner. So some of the stuff that you talk about at Accelerator, and but really making sure that people are aware of that and that it's in our handbook right from when someone starts with us, so they can see I have a long future at this company if I want to be here. And so I think showing that right at the start and having it as part of our open communication with everybody is important.
Yeah, 100%. Okay, so if there's ambiguity in where you can go, I mean, they're gonna look elsewhere. If you set a path within the company where they can go, you have a higher chance of retaining them. Okay. Type in the chat if that makes sense to everybody. We're gonna set expectations. Just give me yes, no, maybe in the chat. You set expectations, you set a path of where they can go. Okay. And then you want to be proactive, not reactive. Okay. So what I find is how many people have like a therapist has come to you and said, hey, I'm taking another offer somewhere else. Okay. Like you're kind of blindsided. Okay. And I find that happens because you're not proactive about talking to people. Are you happy with your pay? Right. Or like, hey, what are your goals within the company? Like, where do you want to go? Like, what's going on in your life? Are you saving for a house? Are you having a baby? Are you paying down debt? I would like to be more proactive. I've learned to be more proactive in my approach so I don't get blindsided. Have you been blindsided, Derek?
Yeah, as you're saying that, I was thinking of several times where I've been blindsided. And I think the other part of being proactive partly is understanding what's happening in their life and also understanding what motivates people, and they tie together. But not everybody's financially motivated. Some people are, and making sure that you're laying out options that speak to their motivators.
And I tell people, like, even Accelerator Collier or the clinics, I want to pay you more. How come you're not making more? Right? I want to pay you more. You're not doing this, or you could be doing this. Do you want to make more? Or even the cultural stuff, right? That you mentioned, right? Are you participating in this? Do you want to like be part of this team? Okay. So I push the agenda, not wait for them to come to me, which they never do. I just usually get a message and be like, hey, like, I'm getting this offer. Can you match it? Right? I want to talk to you. I hate getting those messages. Can we talk? Right? Oh man. I never had someone send me a message, can we talk? And it was like, I love what you're doing here. You know? It's always I have to take them to bubble tea and it's like bad news. You know, if someone wants to go to bubble tea, it's bad news. That's why I have like I don't like bubble tea anymore. Okay. So we're gonna go to look at these tools now. So we're gonna go through what's called a value stack. Okay, this is part of set expectations. A path, okay, setting a clear path of where they can go. And then, of course, like having a transparent compensation model, because if it's not transparent, again, people will go to the lowest common denominator. Okay, so let's take a look at what a value stack or negotiation stack is. It's essentially, this is a very old school method, not something I created, okay, or Derek and I created. It's basically showing all the things of value that the company is offering this person, okay, that they can take advantage of. And I find personally, I've worked with hundreds of clinic owners, they're way too modest. And having it on one slide shows the clinician like what they get, not just their fee split, okay? And you put an actual monetary value to these things, okay? So they can see. Derek, do you offer a signing bonus?
Yeah, we offer a
Okay.
signing bonus and then a referral bonus too.
Okay, it should be on here, referral bonus. Clinical mentorship, you guys do that?
Definitely.
Okay, so if you do an hour a week of mentorship, that's 4 hours a month at $100 an hour, it's $400 a month, 4,800 a year. Okay. You put them in an external program like Daryl's Mentorship Bootcamp and Accelerator, That's $200 a month. If they paid for themselves, it's $2,400 for the year. Okay. And you put all the monetary values here and then all the non-monetary here and take them through it one by one. And it creates this overwhelming feeling of value. Okay. You have these things in place, but are they presented in this way? So you show it during the interview stage, but you should also be popping it up like at your one-on-ones with them. Remember, being proactive because you want to retain these people. Okay. Hey, did you use your continuing ed? Hey, how come you're not doing the clinical mentorship available to you? Right. These are all things of value, but you got to push the agenda. Okay. You can also do it this way where you stack it. This is like a very traditional stack where you show them one by one. And at the bottom, the total is like increasing. Okay. It's another just way to express the value stack to show them it's like building, 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 and it hits this like total value. Here's an example of a company in the US called Athletico. Okay. This is their value stack that they show. Okay. I took a screenshot. So they do the clinical mentorship, continuing ed, benefits. They show their values, pursue your passion, work in different geographic regions, work with the patient populations you want. Okay. And here's career advancement, emerging leadership program. Okay. But this is what they show each candidate and they show their employees and go through each one by one. So that's the value stack. Okay. Again, as we go through these tools, they're adding to retaining this person. Okay. At the very least, you're going to come across transparent and organized right there.
Great.
Okay. I think I've won a lot of negotiations there. I don't know. You do a lot of negotiations there. If the person who seems more organized and transparent wins a lot of deals and
Oh,
keeps a lot of people, right?
absolutely. Yeah.
I've negotiated against, I know, like when I'm hiring someone or retaining someone, I know that they're talking to a few other owners. And if the other owner is just kind of verbally saying these things, and I have it like listed like this, and we go over step by step, I win a lot of negotiations that way. Okay. And now here is the career path slide or company path slide. I don't know if you should say career path with an independent contractor, but maybe company path. Is this something like you have, Derek? Like maybe take us through this.
Yeah, definitely. So we at some of our clinicians are contractors. We try to bring everyone in as employees. Doesn't work for everybody, but yeah. So starting out as a clinician and then moving on to either bringing on an assistant, taking on some sort of outside role. Maybe they are the education lead, as you have their culture. They can do community events, recruiting. So all the ones you have listed there are all important paths that are A, they get compensation for anything that they do outside of their clinical role. So that's an important part, but they're also developing new skills and they can try out a role. And if they like it and they're interested in continuing down that path, then we invest in them. I've put people through university programs who are interested in marketing. And so we're really interested in investing in any path that they choose. So any of those. On the clinician path, moving into clinic director, so overseeing the whole clinic, taking on a lot more responsibility, learning the finances, learning all of the stuff that goes into that, which there's a big learning curve there. And that starts at the step before as they come into a management role. But then, if all is going well and they're enjoying it, then becoming a partner is certainly on the table for anyone in our company.
100%. So you can see, like, as they go through this company path, and you show them this early, you're talking about that they're one-on-one. You can see they can make more money as they progress, diversify their work. They have somewhere to go, and if they don't know where they're going, where they can go in the company, of course, their eyes are going to start looking outside to create a path for themselves. Okay. One thing I would add, that was a really great description, Derek. Like, one thing I would add. As they go through this path, they're actually solving company problems or opportunities, right? So it's a win-win for them. Okay, they make more money, they diversify their work. It's a win for the company because things that we don't have the bandwidth to do, they can take on. Okay, challenges and opportunities. Okay, now remember, this is compounding in their experience. You're showing them the value stack, you're showing them a path in the company. Okay, and then you hit them with the actual compensation model. Okay, I'll zoom out just a little bit. Okay, and I like to show that in this order. I won't show the compensation model until I've showed the value stack and then the career path. Okay. Because you're getting to know them and they're, I think you mentioned this before, even this webinar, like they're in their motivators, right, Derek? Like some people are motivated by money at this point. Some people are motivated by education at this point. Some people are not motivated by money. So you got to be a little sensitive to that with these tools as you go. Right. Okay. But now to retain them, you have this compensation model. It's very clear. It's based on simple rules that they can follow. Like there's only two criteria here. You get paid based on your experience level and your loyalty, how long you've been with the company. Okay. We take them through the difference between employee versus contractor in a simple like check table so they understand the difference. Okay. We also advise them to go have their own like HR person professional so that they can explain the difference. Okay. We share with them where the fee split goes to the company. Okay. So I've seen a lot of cases where this clinician has left because they think the owner's putting all the money in their pocket. They don't know where the split's going. Okay. I had an owner lose three staff because they had a holiday party at their house. And the person saw their house and was like, oh my God, this person's like crushing it. Right? They got a new Tesla. Look at this house. And then because the company and the owner didn't explain, hey, your split goes to all these things we do for you. Okay. And again, you won't know the person feels this way unless you're broaching the subject, being proactive about it. Okay. And I'll just get down to some of the incentive options. So you have your split paid based on simple rules. You've explained to them where the split's going to the company, how it's used. And then if they want to make more money, you can create, think of like a restaurant menu with like an appetizer selection, and they can pick which incentive they want. Okay. And you can pick it once a quarter. I won't get into the details, but maybe Derek, what's a couple incentives you guys offer your clinic?
We have weekend bonuses, recruiting bonus, some of the non-monetary ones. We bring people on as employees, so there's benefits there. We have our learning sessions, team events. We have benefits programs. We're looking at retirement investment funds for people and mentorship. So those are all incentives, vacation and sick time.
And how would you like, say I was your clinician, like how would you present it to me? Do you sit down with me? Is it once a quarter?
Yeah, so initially we sit down and we look at the different pay model options and understand what's most interesting to you and then create this summary similar to this. So we would take a model similar to what you have here and then condense it down for the final version to show them these are some of the things you've selected. So we'd review the options and what values there and then condense it down so it's very easy for them to understand what are they getting here. Because a contract that's 20 pages or whatever it is can be tough to digest. So we condense it down for them.
And in this model, you have your incentive clearly stated. Not everybody gets the incentive. It has to be triggered. So, like, you won't get an incentive if you're part-time. Like, you have to be full-time for this one. You have to have like a certain caseload to percentage to get this one, utilization to get this one. So you have to hit these like lower minimums for this incentive to become active, right? What also gives them something to shoot for, and then the math, like the calculation, so it's clear if they've earned it or not. Okay. And you also want to put in levels in some of these incentives. It doesn't want to be so black and white, right? Like, oh, if the incentive was to get 10 and you got 9, oh, sorry, you didn't get it. Well, guess what? That's going to be a demotivator to someone. Okay. So you want to have a level, hey, you hit 7, you get this. You hit 9, you get this. Oh, you hit 15, it's like a stretch incentive. You get this. Okay. So at least they get something. I found that it becomes a demotivator. It's just black and white. Okay. And they ended up resenting me. All right. And I should say this too. You should build incentives because you want them to hit it. Okay. I've seen people build incentives and got mad when the person hit it. I'm like, no, like you build incentives because you're going to win from it and they're going to win from it. Like you should help them hit it. Okay. So I know that was I think Terry, you and I were talking about it's a kind of a tough task to get all this in 20, 25 minutes.
Yeah.
But this is something, a topic that just never goes away, like in an industry of like very low employment. Okay. How are you setting up your retainment strategies. Okay. And yeah, we're happy to share with you at least three tools that we use: the value stack, the company path, and the compensation model. But my biggest advice to you is be proactive about it. The best you can do is have your one-on-ones, be in tune with what non-monetary things they want and monetary things they want. And I like telling people, like, hey, you should be making more here. How do we do that? So maybe I'll throw it to you, Terry, to kind of take us through some next steps.
Sure. So a couple of things for everybody that's in this meeting, as Sanjeev just mentioned, there's a lot to this topic and it's hard to cover it off in 20 minutes. So we've tried to hit a lot of the highlights here. If you have any questions, by all means, don't hesitate to email us and ask, and we can even get on a call or whatever to get into more details on specific topics. Personally, what I'm getting out of this is that it definitely sounds like something that, A, you need to be, quite prepared before talking to new staff, potential staff, existing staff. Make sure you've got this plan in place before you sit down with them. And it also sounds like something that you really need to actually revisit on a regular basis and make sure that they're still engaged. So just to wrap up here, there's a few things that you can use inside Jivano. Sanjeev and Derek were mentioning things like utilization, PVA, revenue assessments. The clinic summary reports, employee sales statistics report will give you those details very easily, so that you can take that data, plug it into your models. And really, it's a matter of also, checking those stats and flagging any staff that you think are, maybe disengaging, like they said. And that's a good opportunity or a good trigger for you to actually, schedule a meeting and proactively discuss compensation with your staff and make sure that, maybe there is something going on and maybe some extra holiday time would be beneficial for them, or, maybe they've got some unexpected expenses and that you need to discuss that with them. So instead of losing them to another clinic, sit down with them.
Yeah, you mind if I just add a little bit here? Is when a staff member leaves, or you kind of know when they're not happy before they leave, right? Like, you get this vibe from, would you say, Derek? Right? Like, I
You
you
both
have
feel
to
it.
look, you both feel it. You got to look at their stats, right? Because if their performance, the utilization, like Terry said, their PVA, the number of assessments they get, okay, how many referrals, they family friend referral, if those stats are not great, they're going to feel it. Okay? And they may think, hey, this is not right, the right place for me. And if you don't see it, okay, you can't get ahead of it. So that's why these reports in Jivano that Terry outlined are so important to look at, if not weekly, at the very least monthly. Okay, because if someone's struggling with their stats, that is the seeds of them leaving. Okay, so this data in Jivano, very important, and get on a regular frequency. I like to look at it weekly, okay, but if you at the very least monthly.
Oh, for sure.
Okay, so you can jump in.
Also got to give a shout out to the Jivano Commission reports. It's taken so many errors out of payroll every 2 weeks. So appreciate
Oh,
those.
yeah. Thanks. All right. Well, I know we're at the end of our time here. So just to wrap up, first up, huge thank you to Derek and Sanjeev. Again, the wealth of knowledge here is just exceptional. I really appreciate it. And as everybody can see, the last point here is if you jump onto our Facebook group for Jivano, you'll be able to actually grab that compensation model template. And lastly, there's a quick survey that's going to pop up if you don't mind doing that, just to help us improve our future webinars and campus. The Jivano team would really appreciate that. Anyway, again, thank everybody for joining us today. Again, thanks, Derek and Sanjeev, for your time. We really appreciate it. And hope everybody has a great rest of your day.